ads in the chat. So we'll just kind of do a really quick basics overview on the budget. If we go to the next slide, the money that school districts get, they come from a variety of places that can, you know, to feed the pond, the money that our schools and our districts rely on. There are the federal funds. Sorry. Can you please make sure you're muted? If the co-host can just check and make sure people are muted. Thank you. So in terms of how our schools and school districts are coming from, if you think of funding for your school and school district as like being water in a lake, you think about where does that water come from? And if you look further upstream and up the waterfall, the lake has several sources of water. There are the federal funds that come from the US government. There are also the money that comes, the state funds, which mostly a lot of it comes from taxes that we pay, maybe income taxes, maybe sales taxes. And then those funds from the state and the federal government, they flow downstream and they come into our school districts. Often,
Angelica, I don't hear anything, but I didn't choose a language. So I wonder if maybe that's the feedback you're getting.
Is there someone who needed to get to the Muslim and the Arabic interpretation and wasn't able to? Could we perhaps have the instructions for the Arabic interpretation given on the main channel quickly?
I want to hear Sophia. Sophia. Yes, yes, go.
Okay, we can move ahead. Again, for Arabic interpretation, please select Portuguese. And then also. Yeah. Our local in Oakland, we have Measure N that helps to fund some programs in middle and high school. And all of those feed this lake with the resources for our school. So one of the main called the local control funding formula. We're gonna watch a quick video. It's just about a minute long. About the local control.
La fórmula de control.
This is one of the major.
سيعرض عليكم بعض الصور أو الفيديوهات التي.
Receive billions in tax dollars under the local control funding.
تحصل على الكثير من الدعم المالي أو من ال LTFF. تحت ال LTFF.
That must is to provide better services for them.
كثير من الدعم المالي يأتي للمدارس والهدف من هذا أن الهدف الحصول على جودة في التعليم لكل الطلاب
English learners and foster youth.
وأن لا يترك أحد خارج هذا الهدف
is spelled out in plans called LCAPs, which parents, students, and teachers must review and help shape.
وما ينفق تحت الـ LCFF.
For example, LA Unified gets more than $1 billion each year in special LCFF funds. High-need students can get shortchanged if districts and charters don't follow LCFF's process closely. You can make sure they get it right by ensuring students receive extra, truly effective services and that community members are directly involved in decision making. That's what it means to deliver on the
promise of LCFF. I'm not sure why the sound was a little soft in parts of it, but that last part was, that's what it means to make real on the promise of LCFF for the local control funding formula. I know some that were plan leaders who were part of winning this law, and parents and students, which was a way to send more funding to school districts like ours that serve more students, low-income students, English learner students, foster youth students. And every year, most of the budget is made up of this local control funding formula money. If we go to the next slide, I'm just going to give an example. The video showed LA and Sacramento. Here in Oakland, Oakland receives approximately $380 million in local control funding formula funds every year. So that's part of the ongoing money. A lot of the money is used to pay for staff. But then with the impact of COVID and the pandemic, last year and this year, school districts are receiving additional money, very significant amount of money because of COVID. And so just to give you an idea, we're going to continue with the Oakland example as an example, but all school districts are receiving additional one-time money to address the impact of this pandemic and address the needs that are arising from it. So I know this is a very, there's a lot of information on this slide, so I'm going to walk us through it. Can we please make sure everyone is muted? Thank you. So just last year alone in Oakland, there was more than $50 million in additional money that the school district received. Much of that was to, you know, address the new needs from distance learning. And also to think about what would they need to open schools safely and be able to protect against the transmission of COVID. That funding has continued. There are new sources of one-time funding. And for Oakland Unified, that's more than $200 million, again, that they are going to be receiving this year. And most of it they've received already. They don't have to spend it all this year. In fact, many of these pots of money, they can spend over multiple years, even as late as 2024. And the biggest source of this money is from the US government, our bills that have been passed in Washington, DC. But the money is, as I mentioned before, it's almost, it's a very significant amount of money even compared to what they get every year, which means it's a very big opportunity. And there are other funds in the state budget that are being considered right now that also can go towards many of the needs that students and families are naming for your schools. So we have this slide available also for other school districts, and we'll make sure to share that out. We definitely have it available already for Hayward. And if you could just make sure to leave your school district in the chat. But here are some of the other districts that we know Plan has families in that I just wanted to share just at the high level of the numbers. So for example, in Hayward, last year, Hayward got more than $24 million of this additional money. And then this year, they will receive more than $70 million. Again, they don't have to spend it all this year. They have several years to spend that money, and they have to make a plan. And so part of the reason that we're telling you all this is if we move forward, Cindy, is that we wanted to talk about, first of all, that the money has many uses. It can be used in many different ways to address the impacts that the pandemic has created and those needs, especially the learning needs of students and the social emotional needs of students, because we know that our students and the families that support them have been very impacted. And so even though the monies are coming from different sources, in general, most of the learning needs that you might be seeing and most of the kind of mental health and social emotional needs that you're seeing among your students, this funding can be used to support that. And I also, we didn't put it here on this list, but family engagement as well is an important need. And if you is really critical to students' learning. And so that's another thing that could be funded with this money. So addressing barriers to learning, social emotional supports and mental health services, training for school staff on how to deal with the impacts of trauma, meeting the needs of students who are English language learners or meeting the needs of Black students, meeting the needs of students with disabilities. These could all be reasons you're using these funds. Addressing the new public health and safety needs that you have in schools because of COVID, right? The school has to operate in a different way to be safe. Purchasing the technology, or maybe you need more staff to be able to operate your school now or your school programs. So we do have this slide translated in Spanish and not in Arabic yet, but hopefully we can work with plan on getting these slides in Arabic too. And so the last thing, I think I wanted to pause very quickly to just ask if there are particular questions here. So I see someone asking, can the funds be used for teacher salaries? So it depends. They are one-time funds, which means that you only get them once and you can't expect that you're gonna get them again next year. So in general, with a good practice of budgeting, if something is only one time, you don't spend it on something that you're gonna have to pay for year after year, or else you might not have the money for it. With that said, because it's so much money and it doesn't have to all be spent in one year, you might be able to pay for a certain salary, you know, or a particular position. Say you wanted to add a new position for a period of years to increase family engagement at your school, or you wanted to have a teacher who was really skilled in literacy and really helping kids catch up on reading over a period of years, you might be able to do that. But school districts and schools have to be cautious because the money is not, unless they have a plan for how they're gonna shift that person's salary to the funding that they have year after year, like the LCFF funding that we talked about, then they may run into a problem where they're not able to maintain that position. What I have heard more suggested, for example, if you wanted to increase teacher compensation, might be you could maybe use this money for bonuses, like a one-time bonus to a teacher or staff member to try to retain them, like knowing that that teachers are underpaid and that you might be, that now many might be thinking about leaving the profession, for example. But it can be used for staff. You just have to be really thoughtful that the money might run out. Is funding 3 years total not the same amount being funded each year? So it's a little bit more complicated. Right now, I was talking about the big amount that I'm talking about, for example, in Oakland, that $200 million is made up of a number of different funding sources. And if we went back to the slide, Cindy, that has the money bags.
Excuse me, mommy's busy.
Can I video?
No, go away. I'm sorry. Excuse me.
Can I video?
No, don't ask me right now. I'm doing a training, please.
Apologies. She just stole my train of thought. But the longest timeline, if we looked at the funding buckets, each one actually has a different timeline. So there is some money that the school district just received, for example, these smaller money bags on the right side, the ones for reopening and expanded learning. Those are only available until the end of next summer, 2022. So you see this blue writing says must use by August 2022. So it can be used through next summer. But this largest money bag, which is the latest funding that was approved by the federal government, you may have heard it called the American Rescue Plan Act, which has more than just education money. There's many other pieces of funding attached to it, but the education money that's part of that, that is available to spend until 2024. So that's the longest timeline. And then some things have other timelines in between. So it's not all 3 years, but the biggest bucket of money, which is that ESSER III bucket here, the biggest money bag, does have a 3-year timeline. So it is a bit complicated, but it is a bit complicated. I think we're gonna have to move forward.
I want to eat another thing. I want to eat something.
So, okay, sorry. I'm gonna pass it now over to Cindy.
Hi again. I think Angelica is gonna share her screen for that, but we're gonna transition into the different plans that exist. So first, families are probably aware of the local control and accountability plan, the LCAP. And that's a 3-year spending document where the district has to describe how it's using the local control funding formula funds and implementing the local control funding formula in its plan to benefit high need students. And again, that's English learners, foster youth, and low income students. And something important to note is that the local control and accountability plan, we also call it the LCAP, it has to be developed in partnership with students, families, and stakeholders. And this year they're writing a new 3-year LCAP. You've probably already, most of you are involved in the process. So it's drafting new goals and parents and students are able to have decision-making power on what are the things the district is gonna do differently, what it's gonna keep and what actions and goals are gonna be in the plan. So it is really a big opportunity to impact the plan because although it does get revised every year, this year is pretty big because they're rewriting the plan completely. Now there's also the school plans.
Am I putting up the right slide that you want me to have up? I just want to.
Thank you. There's also now like the school plans for student achievement, also called the SIPSA, which is like the LCAP, but it's really at the school level. And both of those plans have to align with each other. The SIPSA should inform the LCAP ideally. And both plans must be adopted by the end of the school year. So the next slide. This year, what's different is that there's this expanded learning plan. So the districts are getting a certain amount of funds to specifically to meet the like mental health needs, kind of like some of the needs that Angelica had mentioned, and they must adopt this expanded learning plan. So it's around like social emotional needs of students. And that plan has to be adopted by June 1st. And there's also a community engagement requirement where parents have to be consulted when spending that plan. Yeah, Angelica?
Can you speak a little slower?
So Cindy, just a little bit slower, and I had heard somebody come off mute. I see somebody's hand raised. Was that a clarifying question? Or are you able to answer that question in the chat, Kimberly?
No, I had a question about the money. Is the money, some of the money going to like for the parents too, or is this just for the school? If that makes any sense.
Yeah, so the funding, it goes to the school districts to decide. So it is going to the school districts to decide, but parents have a right to have your voice heard in how that money should be spent. And in particular, both for the district plan at the LCAP and also this special expanded learning plan, and for the school plan, parents actually in the law have a right to have a say in how that money gets spent. And so I'm not sure if you're asking, Kimberly, about like direct payments to parents or if you're more talking about maybe services or supports that parents might need at a school site.
Right.
But depending, you know, if there are particular services or engagement staff or maybe there's a better way that food delivery could, you know, nutrition or other kind of things are not working for families at that school site, parents should have a way to weigh in and have a say about how that money gets spent. And maybe there are, you know, suggestions in hiring parents to support some of that work.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for that question.
Yo tengo una pregunta, la señora Marina.
This is Marina, and I have a question. Marina.
Okay. Okay, sí, siga, señora Marina.
Sí.
estoy oyendo. I am listening. So good afternoon, everybody. My name is Marina Muñoz. I was for 3 years in the LCAP. And I think that is very important, really, right? That we use this money, right? To for the students who have many needs. I know that the English learners need a lot of help. And right up till now, there hasn't been that help. And also children with disabilities, during the pandemic, it's been very difficult at home to give them the studies that they knew because their parents get there. They don't know what to do. They haven't gone to a school. I think that we have to pay for workshops for the parents for the, with that money that is coming to the district, to the schools.
Me he dado cuenta de que
I have seen that there are many needs in our schools, and we need to see what are the priorities to for spending these funds.
Los padres están viendo y cómo.
Cindy, I think you have.
See, no, she has to speak in English.
Yes, thank you, Marina. That's great input. We'll have an activity today where we're really talking about what parents and students are seeing as needs and how to advocate for those needs to be heard. So I heard Marina say that English learners need extra supports and students with disabilities need extra supports. So these plans are an opportunity to be able to advocate for those needs. And there's so much funding coming in that it is a real opportunity to really push for those services that we know work for our students. So because we're running out of time, I'm gonna skip to the next slide.
Yo represento aquí en mi distrito de Oakland.
I represent my district in Oakland.
She's a parent representing Oakland. She's been involved in the LCAP for some time. And then we'll also in a few minutes hear from Alexia of how she's been able to advocate for some of the needs at her school site. So next slide, Angelica. Thank you. So there's so many ways that parents can get involved, and there isn't really like one right way. There's different opportunities. We'll talk more about the school level committees through Alexia's experience, but what's required, and there may be other committees, but what's required in a school district is that every district have a school site council. And if a school, every school in a district have a school site council, and every school that has more than 21 English learners must have an English learner advisory committee. There's also the same thing, but at the district level. So every district has to have a parent advisory committee that's majority parents of English learners, low-income students, and foster youth. And every district that has either 15% or more of English learners or more than 50 English learners, they must have a district English learner advisory committee. Each committee looks different in each district, but these are the required committees. And next slide, please. So if for my portion, if there's anything.
May I say something that I forgot?
Oh. También yo creo que es muy
I also think that it's very important, right? That people who interpret are paid. So when we have meetings, when they explain to you how your children are doing, there is no interpretation. You cannot communicate with the teachers when they speak English and we speak Spanish. So can we spend some of that money on that?
That language access, because such a big part is that connection with between the parent, the student, and the teacher. And if there's that barrier, then creating that connection is going to be harder. So those are supports that folks can push for and are also part of your rights as parents. So like I was saying, if there's anything you really take away from my portion of this presentation is that, like, as parents and as students, like, you have a right to be in these spaces. You have a right to ask your questions, to get the answers that you want, and to really support each other through this process. So there's so many parents, you know, that aren't able to be here today, but I hope as like a takeaway, you know, it is a big responsibility that you have, but you know, it's our responsibility to make sure that these plans do reflect the parent and student voice and really hold districts accountable so that they're not just checking boxes, but that there's real community engagement at every step of the process. So I'm gonna stop there, and I'm gonna transition into the next portion of the training where Alexia, who's a parent, is in Oakland, is going to give an example of how she's been able to win, sir. And if folks
can be, you know, can we make sure everyone is muted?
Yes.
And Kelly's going to go on
mute. Yeah. So Alexia and Kelly, well, Alexia's going to talk about how she's been able to win support at her school site, and Kelly's going to facilitate the conversation. So I'll pass it over to them.
So Alexia, what is the need that you identified?
One second. The first need, the need that we've identified in school is that our kids need help with that, with academic mentors and supports in homework. And some of our newcomers need help with the English learning to understand the curriculum and the school.
So what is the service that you wanted to see to address that need?
We suggested to the principal if he can bring to us the extra help from the academic mentors. From, we know we have them from fifth grade to eighth grade, so we propose having them from first grade to eighth grade. So that way the teachers on the lower level will have the same support as the teachers from the higher level.
And how did you advocate for this service to be funded in your school plan?
The way that I have, that we, not myself, that we advocate for that is cutting edges. Let's say if we needed money for field trips a week, we can spend that money for education in our children. We send that money there, and if we can make food sales or any other type of event so we can get money for the non more important things, we used to do that. So that's our plan. We advocate for the things that we need to educate our children, and for the lower things, there's so much funding you can find, like the museum, the zoo gives you free ticket, all those things. So we plan to do that. Like for the next year, we're gonna do the same thing.
Okay, thank you so much for sharing your example, Alexia, from your school site council. That's at La Escuelita in Oakland. And I'm also hearing other people sharing who are in their SSCs. And I want to recognize that your positive experience with your school site council is not the same experience that many families have. You did share that you have a principal who really does encourage the leadership of ideas and encourages sharing power and sharing decision-making authority with the parents and the teachers. And that's what we want at every school site. We're gonna take a moment now to shift and be able to have you all share among yourselves about what are the supports that you see in your school site. We heard Marina also sharing ideas. What are you as a parent or your student needing in your school? And then one idea for how you could advocate for that. Let me get back to the slides just to show you what we're gonna be doing next. And Cindy, you're set. Cindy is getting us ready for the breakout, I believe. So, here we go. So here we go. We're going to go into breakouts. We're going to have three rooms. Cindy, do you think we need to make more than three rooms, or you think we can try to, we'll try this, but three rooms, they're going to be large breakouts. And we were going to, actually, we're only two rooms plus plus we were going to have interpretation in this room, right? So we were going to ask all the Arabic speakers to stay here with me and Alexia. And we can also have some Spanish speakers in here as well, because I think we can do that interpretation. We are going to have one room in Spanish that will be Shilpa and Eliasar in that room. And then we'll have breakout room 2 in English with Cindy and Kelly. And so people will be able, in those rooms, we're going to answer these two questions. What is one thing students or families need right now to succeed and feel supported in school? And the second question is, what is one next step, you can take to advocate for this support? And I just wanted to name that even if we don't have enough time to discuss, we have a Padlet. Where do we have the Padlet? To be able to pick your breakout room, what's going to happen is that you'll go down to breakout rooms, the boxes here, and then when you open the breakout room screen, it doesn't show up for me, sorry. When you open the breakout room screen, you can either pick the room that says, do the rooms look like this, Cindy? You can pick English, you could pick the Spanish room, or you can just stay here too. It's okay to stay here if this is too confusing. But to pick, you have to click on the blue number. For the folks going into your rooms, for my note takers, do you have access to the Padlet? And when we go into our rooms, again, the questions we're discussing is, what is one thing students or families need right now to succeed and feel supported in school? And then what is one next step you can take to advocate for this support? So the breakout rooms are now open and people can choose to go down to the English room. You go over the number, you can go to the Spanish room, or you could stay in here with me and we'll still have interpretation in here. So we'll also ask all the Arabic speakers to please stay here so we can have interpretation for you. I will also share in the chat the Padlet.